Welcome to a special edition of Living Truth, shot on location in Greece and Turkey. In this program, we'll step back into the ancient world as we travel in the footsteps of the Apostle Paul on his missionary journeys to these beautiful countries. We'll visit historic sites and study God's Word, considering how it impacted the people of the time and continues to transform us 2,000 years later. Stay with Living Truth for a message from Hillary Price.
All of life's journey eventually will bring us to a place when we are alone with God.
This message was recorded in Athens, Greece, during a retreat with Living Truth viewers on the shore of the Aegean Sea.
I'm going to focus on John. I've studied now his life, the beloved disciple, for months before coming to this, and I've actually grown to love, understand, appreciate John in a way that I hadn't. But because I knew we were going to Patmos, I immediately thought that's where my heart wants to be. So that's, I'm going to speak to you out of John and his experiences on Patmos. And John's journey is a fascinating journey. It began on the shores of Lake Galilee, where some of you have actually been. And he was there with his brother James, and they met Jesus one day. And he was a young man, he was a fisherman, and because of what happened on the shore of Galilee, he ended up on the shores of Patmos. And it's the journey in between that I want to look at with you. He was a young man at the beginning, he was a very old man at the end, probably a stooped old man, but he was still standing in Christ. It's an amazing picture of courage in a person. I want you to now kind of think back to Patmos, and I want you to think of the craggy rock aspect of it all. And it was on that island that John was given the revelation of Jesus Christ. So I want you to turn to Revelation chapter 1. And we're going to start with the revelation at the beginning, him being on the island, and then we're going to go back and trace his journey from the Galilee shore to Patmos. So Revelation chapter 1, verse 1, the revelation from Jesus Christ, which God gave to show his servants what must soon take place. He made it known by sending his angel to his servant John, who testifies to everything he saw. That is the word of God and the testimony of Jesus Christ. Blessed is the one who reads aloud the words of this prophecy, and blessed are those who hear it and take to heart what is written in it, because the time is near. John, to the seven churches in the province of Asia, grace and peace to you from him who is, and who was, and who is to come, and from the seven spirits before his throne, and from Jesus Christ, who is the faithful witness, the firstborn from the dead, and the ruler of the kings of the earth. To him who loves us and has freed us from our sins by his blood, and has made us to be a kingdom and priests to serve his God and Father, to him be glory and power forever and ever. Amen. Look, he is coming with the clouds, and every eye will see him, even those who pierced him, and all peoples on earth will mourn because of him. So shall it be. Amen. I am the Alpha and the Omega, says the Lord God, who is and who was and who is to come, the Almighty. I, John, your brother and companion in the suffering and kingdom and patient endurance that are ours in Jesus, was on the island of Patmos because of the word of God and the testimony of Jesus. On the Lord's day, I was in the Spirit, and I heard behind me a loud voice like a trumpet, which said, write on a scroll what you see, and send it to the seven churches, to Ephesus, Smyrna, Pergamum, Thyatira, Sardis, Philadelphia, and Laodicea. And many of you visited those places. So the spiritual climate was not unlike our own. And because of the despots and the dictators and people with illusions to grandeur who are still very present in the world, often very little men with very grand ideas about themselves, it would have been very easy to become overwhelmed with fear and to begin to believe that the future belonged to the Roman emperor and to the dictators. And we could be led to believe that. We look at our world today and we could start to think, well, that person ruling in that country wanting to take over the world, we have despots in our world, is going to win the day. But they're not. They always fall. Shakespeare talks about who's in, who's out, who's up, who's down, and there's a rhythm to the dictators of the world. And the reason is the future belongs to nobody but Jesus Christ. It doesn't belong to any ruler and the way he might be trying to manipulate the world. So John lives in the midst of this pagan atmosphere. And John is bombarded by the media, exactly as we are. He's not bombarded with images and laptops and TV, but he is bombarded with their media, which was statues and symbols and graffiti and temples, and it was as loud and dominant then as it is for us today. But in the midst of it all, John knows the future belongs to Jesus Christ, and I belong to Jesus Christ, and I am a citizen of heaven, not of Rome. Therefore, I'm a stranger in the world, I'm a sojourner, and the things of the world don't hold me, they don't hold any interest for me, because there's another world. This is not all there is. And it's interesting when you look at these vast, impressive temples, which we've seen, and colonnades and pillars and amphitheaters, and they, when they were built, they must have looked so permanent. In King Lear, Shakespeare says, "As flies to wanton boys are we to the gods, they kill us for their sport." And these gods that people worshipped were not good gods. They were capricious, they were unpredictable, they were cruel, and worship of them led people into bondage. And in the midst of all this, John in verse 5 shows his complete confidence in Jesus, him who loves us and has freed us from our sins, which is completely the opposite of what was happening between the gods and their people. So John affirms in this culture that God loves us personally and we can have an intimate relationship with God. This is an era where the individual person did not count. And they created vast buildings and statues which were designed to make the leaders look big and the people feel very little. But we know Jesus, and Jesus knows us, and Jesus knows us by name. There are so many times in the Gospels when he will say somebody's name, Mary, Philip, how did you know me? I'm standing under the tree. Zacchaeus, come out of the tree. Whoever you are not unknown, you are known, and Jesus knows your name. And not only does he know us, but he loves us. And these gods with little g's did not love people. They just used people. And they were a figment of their imagination anyway, because they didn't exist. And John says, having loved his own who were in the world, he loved them to the uttermost. And when I see John on Patmos, I feel he's arrived at the uttermost. You might have arrived at the uttermost in your life. He's arrived at the uttermost in his age. He's almost as old as he can get. In his location, he's almost gone as far away as he can go. And in his isolation, he is alone. And he's left behind him a world that he doesn't know he will ever go back to. He never knew if he would come off Patmos. Patmos was a punishment for him. Sometimes we get into a situation where we don't know if this is the end of the road for us, and John didn't know either. And this is, I want you to think back to when we were in Ephesus and how we sailed from Ephesus and we sailed to Patmos, and this was John's journey. And as he left Ephesus, this is what he was leaving behind. And you saw this. A street that led eastwards, flanked by gymnasiums and other sports facilities, to the magnificent 25,000 seat theater, and upwards to Mount Pion rising behind it. South of the theater, the messenger who would be bringing eventually John's letters would see the commercial center, where the silversmiths had their workshops, and beyond it the temple dedicated to the worship of Domitian. And inside was a statue of the emperor himself, four times life size. Its head depicted the emperor of Zeus, the ruler of the gods. There could be no more vivid reminder of its totalitarian demands. So in this context, and we've seen it, John is faithfully loving God, and because their lives were lived very much in the open air, there was very little privacy, and so it gave opportunities to share Christ with people, very natural opportunities, which John did, and of course it got him into trouble. So once he's on the Isle of Patmos, God gives him these letters to send back to the churches, and they're basically to do four things: to assure the believers that God is on the throne, whoever else around them is putting themselves on the throne, to comfort those who are being persecuted, to correct heresy, which was starting to creep into the church, and to give courage and understanding for what lay ahead. And John testified, and because of the word of God, he ended up on Patmos. And he's still testifying on Patmos. He cannot stop talking about Jesus Christ. So verse 9 says, I was on the island of Patmos, which you now can envisage. And in verse 10, he says, I was in the Spirit. So this afternoon, I want to talk about that statement, I was on the island of Patmos. So what took John on this personal journey to Patmos? How did he come to that island? I don't know if you ever thought about this concept, but you are the end of the road for God. God so loved the world, he sent his only begotten Son. So God came into the world. Why did he come into the world? To live inside you. So you are the end of the road. You are God's destination. But God is the end of the road for us. God is also our destination. My Father and I will make our home in you. When we come home, we have come to Christ. That's what coming home is. And I realize that all of life's journey eventually will bring us to a place when we are alone with God. It doesn't matter how many people you've surrounded yourself with, friends, family, work colleagues, there will come a time when it will just be you and God. And I used to think, it seems very unfair, when you get older, you become more and more dependent. We start our lives completely dependent as babies in a little crib, and we need people. And then our world blossoms and we branch out and we leave the little crib and we start to walk and we wander all over the world. And then life has a way of shrinking back again. And a lot of people end their lives back in a little crib. Why does God do that? I think he does it because he's giving us one final opportunity to say, I need you. If we haven't found him up to that point, when we are back in that place of complete dependence and we know we can't do anything for ourselves and we can't extend our lives, that's God saying, I am the end of the road. Let's meet. You now know you need me. And what an amazing mercy it is when you meet him early on that journey, when you just got out of the crib, when you were a little child, when you were a teenager. You didn't have to get to that back in your crib as a 100-year-old saying, wow, it was all about God and I didn't realize. What a mercy when you meet him early on. And life will bring us one by one to our own Patmos, where it's just you and God.
This is a special edition of Living Truth, recorded on location in Greece and Turkey. Living Truth viewers joined Hillary and Charles Price on an unforgettable trip following in the footsteps of Paul, along with exploring biblically historic sites such as Ephesus in Turkey. Our time together included destinations such as Pergamum, Sardis, Pamukkale, and Cappadocia. Our Living Truth travelers also enjoyed visiting the Greek islands of Santorini, Patmos, Rhodes.
The Greek island of Patmos, just off the coast of Turkey, may be tiny, but its biblical significance is huge. The book of Revelation explicitly states that it was written while the Apostle John was in exile on the island. This is the only book in the New Testament where the place of writing is given.
This series was recorded on location in Turkey and Greece and is available on CD and DVD. Learn at home, give to a friend, or plan a group Bible study. To order this series, write to the address on your screen. To order this series, go to livingtruth.ca for details. Receive the gospel and experience Turkey and Greece as you follow in the footsteps of Paul.
We now return to our message from Hilary Price.
Let me read what Oswald Chambers says. A servant of God must stand so very much alone that he never realizes he is alone. In the early stages of the Christian life, disappointments will come. People who used to be lights will flicker out, and those who used to stand with us will turn away. We have to get used to it, that we will not even realize we are standing alone. Paul said, "No one stood with me, all forsook me, but the Lord stood with me and strengthened me." 2 Timothy 4:16 to 17. We must build our faith not on fading lights, but on the light that never fails. When important individuals go away, we are sad until we see that they are meant to go, so that the only thing is left for us to do to look into the face of God for ourselves. I can personally testify that I did that actually not far from here. I became a Christian when I was 19 and I was at university. My parents divorced, my world fell apart, and I had a really, really good friend who led me to Christ. And before I came to Christ, I'd planned with some friends to backpack around Europe, which in those days you could do for about $80 for a month. So we met in London, we sat on the station, we said, "Where should we go?" And I said, "Let's go to a Greek island." We were young and free. So we came to a Greek island, but we actually came to Paros, which I think we passed in the night the other night. I looked at it. It's 40 years since I came to this part of the world. So I was a 19-year-old student. I'm a 59-year-old grandmother now. I would never have believed I would be back here teaching the Bible to people at that point in my life. On that journey to Paros, I fell asleep. Jesus has only come to me twice in dreams. Some people have a lot of dreams, but for me, I've only experienced Christ's presence in dreams twice. I experienced him on a ferry from Piraeus to Paros in a dream. And in my dream, I have a very vivid imagination, and I love literature and movies, and I had seen a film called The Crack Down the Center of the Earth or something. And in the film, this couple is standing, and suddenly this enormous crack opens up, and they're standing on the edge of it, and it's moving apart. And I was standing on the edge of this crack, looking into it, and I was actually terrified. And I was terrified because, not just because I was in this sort of dream and the crack was opening up, I was terrified of being alone, of falling in there alone. And I was terrified of being alone because my home had broken up, and I felt a loneliness and a loneliness like I'd never known in my life. My home didn't exist anymore. So home became incredibly important to me, and I hadn't found home at this point. But I had found Jesus 3 weeks earlier. I'd sat in my garden, I'd said, "Jesus, I don't understand you. I don't feel I've really worked through all the things I need to. If I tick all these boxes, you're going to be there, but I don't want to tick any more boxes. I just sense you're there, and I'm just giving myself to you." So I gave all of me to him, and I discovered years later that he had given all of himself to me. I didn't really know that at the time. I just said, "Jesus, I believe. I don't know a lot, but I believe." So I was a very, very young Christian. But my greatest fear was of being abandoned. And Jesus knew that. He knew that when I didn't know that. So when I thought I was going to fall into this big crevasse and I was on the ferry to Paros, Jesus came and said to me, "Never will I leave you. Never will I forsake you." And that's all I needed to know. That's all I've needed to know all my life. Maybe one day I'll tell the other thing that he told me in a dream, because it was the only other thing I ever needed to know. Never will I leave you. Never will I forsake you. And I've actually always known Jesus is there. I've had huge struggles, but I've never doubted his promise to me that day. And in John's life, Jesus jumped in where John was, and John wasn't perfect by any means, and we're going to see that. And they walked together, and they had this deep love relationship. And this is where I identify so much with this beloved disciple of love. I don't know if when I say to you, God will get you on your own, what that feels like to you, whether that's a wonderful thing or a threatening thing. And you might feel very alone and very lonely in your aloneness. You might never have married, and you would love to marry. And you've always felt that little gnawing loneliness inside you. You're what my stepdad's lovely old aunt, in her, she lived to be 100, and she used to say to me, people would say to her, are you single? She'd say, no, I'm just an unclaimed treasure. And she said that till she was 100. So you're still an unclaimed treasure. You might have married, but actually, you know, 20 years, 30 years down the track, you are in a loveless marriage, and you are very lonely in your marriage. You might have had an amazing marriage, and now you're a widow or a widower, and it's a very lonely place to be. You might have had a big family, and your children have moved on, and you're kind of left behind saying, hello, you know, I'm still here. That can be a very lonely place to be. You might be very lonely at work because you're the boss and people don't treat you as a human being and you have a lot of responsibility and nobody understands. That can be an incredibly lonely place to be. And the Christians that John was writing to were inclined to despair because of the circumstances they found themselves in. And when we despair, God comes and reminds us, not about what's going on and not about what we have, but about who we are. And he reminds us, you are a kingdom and priests. They were becoming incredibly isolated in this culture, but they are priests. And priests never despair. The reason they never despair is because they always have access to their Heavenly Father, to God in heaven. In the Old Testament, a sign of mourning and desperation and despair was to tear your clothes because you couldn't cope. Priests were never allowed to tear their clothes. They didn't need to because they had direct access to the Father. I don't know if you've ever understood the significance of the soldiers casting lots, throwing dice for Jesus's robe and not tearing the robe, which was prophesied. But it also showed that at the darkest moment of history, when you would think Jesus would be tempted to despair, he is the great high priest, and his robe was not torn. And even when he cries out, my God, why have you forsaken me? He then says, into your hands I commit my spirit. So even though he can't see him and feel him, he's still aware. He is the great high priest, and John says, you are priests. You have access to the Father. You have no need to be overwhelmed with despair. But we have to access. It's no good just saying we have access if we don't actually go there. And John has a history with Jesus. He has a love relationship. Verse 5, to him who loves us, not loved us. So when we get into a place like an island of pain and loneliness, it's very tempting to start questioning the love of God, the very fact that you are there. It's very tempting to degenerate into despair and self-pity. But when you keep trusting Jesus, you will see beyond what you can see. The revelation that John is given, the apocalypse means unveiling, uncovering. It's as though Jesus is pulling back a curtain and saying, this is reality. This is the real story. And whatever John could see under his nose, he always trusted that there was a bigger story going on. And in verse 7, John says, look, he is coming with the clouds. That is a fantastic statement, because we tend to think when the clouds come, he's gone. I'm under a cloud. He is coming with the clouds. And when John writes the book of Revelation, which I hope you'll read at some point, he's writing about what he can see. He's writing about sea and sky and fiery red as the sun goes down and islands. And he's actually looking at what we could see from Patmos. And he's sitting on an island and the clouds are gathering, and in the clouds he sees Jesus. Jesus comes with the clouds. The world owes much of its beauty to cloudland. The unchanging blue of the Italian sky hardly compensates for the changefulness and the glory of the clouds. Earth would become a wilderness apart from their ministry. There are clouds in human life, shadowing, refreshing, and sometimes draping it in blackness of night. But there is never a cloud without its bright light. I do set my bow in the cloud. If we could see the clouds from the other side, where they lie in billowy glory, bathed in the light they intercept, like heaped ranges of Alps, we should be amazed at their splendid magnificence. And hopefully when you flew, there's that moment you shoot through the cloud and you're looking down on this billowing magnificence. We look at their underside, but who shall describe the bright light that bathes their summits and searches their valleys and is reflected from every pinnacle? Is not every drop drinking in health-giving qualities which it will carry to the earth? O child of God, if you could see your sorrows and troubles from the other side, if instead of looking up at them from the earth, you would look down on them from heavenly places where you sit with Christ, if you knew how they are reflecting in prismatic beauty before the gaze of heaven, the bright light of Christ's face, you would be content that they should cast their deep shadows over the mountain slopes of existence. Only remember that clouds are always moving and passing before God's cleansing wind. The clouds come and God's cleansing wind comes, and they herald God's presence. They do not obscure it or negate it. And so John knows all about this world beyond the cloud. John had been there when Jesus pulled back the curtain and had revealed the world beyond the cloud. And therefore, John is the perfect person to receive the revelation. He's not cynical and he's not skeptical. He fully believes and has seen the other world. He wrote, "In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God. The Word was God. He was with God in the beginning." He knew there was an amazing mystery to Jesus, and he embraced the mystery. He knew Jesus had come from another place. He knew he was returning to another place. He had defied time and space and life and death. And John loved it and he embraced it all. "We beheld his glory," he said. In 1 John 1:1, he says, "That which was from the beginning we have heard, we have seen with our eyes, we have looked at and our hands have touched. This we proclaim concerning the word of life."
You are watching a special edition of Living Truth, recorded on location in Greece and Turkey.
The joy of the Scriptures is that the Holy Spirit can make God's Word alive to us daily, wherever we live, and however different our world may seem. Christ's presence is within us by faith. We can all experience this at any time, leading us in our walk with Him and inspiring us to share our faith.
This is a special edition of Living Truth, recorded on location in Greece and Turkey. Living Truth viewers traveled to Greece and Turkey to explore and experience the Living Bible. Let's return to our message from Hilary Price.
So how was it that John got so close to Jesus that he touched him? How was it that he knew he was loved by him? Well, if you go back to the beginning of his journey on the shore at Galilee, it's very simple. It began with one step. Your journey with Jesus began with one step, in one place, in one moment, on one day. If you are on a journey with Jesus, some of you may not be on the journey because you have never taken the one step. Remember, he was on the seashore in Mark chapter 1, and Jesus saw James, the son of Zebedee, and John, his brother. They were in the boat, mending nets, and immediately he called them, and they left their father Zebedee in the boat with the hired servants and went away to follow him. I don't know if you've ever thought about that moment when Zebedee is on the beach with his boys, James and John. These are boys who are now young men. He's been bringing them up to be fishermen and part of his crew. And along comes somebody who he's never seen before and says, "Come with me," and they say, "Bye, Dad, we're off." How would that feel for Zebedee? How would that feel for the boys? I think it's an incredibly challenging moment, actually. It's an amazing sacrifice. Zebedee has poured his life into these boys. He's taught him all his skills as fishermen. And he's probably willed the company to them. And they're leaving. They left the father. We have to be very careful that we don't make children idols, where we don't say, well, I've invested all this in them, and therefore they have to do this, this, and this. God will never waste what you've invested in your children, but he might not lead them to do what you expect them to do with it. I know that in our own lives with our children. Two of our girls live in very, very challenging places, and we've let them go. And Zebedee let these boys go. And what I think is beautiful is that Jesus came and said, Zebedee, I don't know if you went and had a chat with him, but you've been a great dad. You've made them great fishers of fish. And because of all the principles you taught them about patience and endurance and watchfulness, I'm going to now be able to make them fishers of men. So nothing's been wasted. You just didn't know you were preparing their whole lives to be my disciples. And that's what you're preparing your children for. And sometimes it gets incredibly difficult. And if Zebedee had still been around, which he wasn't, because he was obviously old and a father, and John was very old and his father would have been dead, but he could have got to the point of thinking, I gave you to Christ and look where you've ended up. You've ended up on Patmos. You're in a prison. You've been persecuted. You're an old man. What is God doing? What is God doing? He's getting him on his own so he can reveal to him one of the most amazing pictures and messages any person has ever heard or seen anywhere. So he let them go, and they followed Jesus. And John followed right into the middle of the inner circle. He was always in the three, Peter, James, and John. And it was the three who always witnessed Jesus pulling aside the curtain and seeing beyond. They were with him when Jairus' daughter was raised. They saw life beyond death. They witnessed the transfiguration. That was life after death. Moses and Elijah were standing there talking. It was an amazing thing that happened. They saw behind the curtain. And John had learnt to listen. And I'm sure he didn't realize he was listening for us as well as himself. But you're never just listening for yourself. Never. I promise you, if God teaches you something, in the next week or month, he will give you the opportunity to share it with somebody else. He comforts you so you can comfort with the comfort that you have received. He's always giving so you can give away. And maybe John heard a little bit more than others, because out of the 12, when they gathered together, he was always the closest. It was tradition that the youngest would sit next to the rabbi, and he was probably the youngest. Whenever you see pictures, which are only pictures, but he's always there and he's always next to Jesus. And we are told now there was one leaning on Jesus' bosom, one of the disciples who Jesus loved. And it's John. And John didn't have to lean on Jesus. That wasn't part of the tradition. The tradition was that he would sit next to him. He leaned on him because he loved him. And because he knew that Jesus loved him. Do you know what it is to lean into Jesus? Lean into him. If you don't trust his love, you will not lean into him. Because you will hold back. And John did not hold back. He leant into Jesus. There are times in our lives when the only thing we know is that God loves us. That's one of those Patmos moments where it's just you and God alone. Nothing else is making sense. Nobody else can make sense of what's happening. And that defined John. Whatever else was happening, he knew God loves me. Jesus is alive and Jesus loves me. You don't realize how essential to your very being the love of Jesus is till it's the only thing you're sure of. You don't realize. And John began to realize as his life went on, he was not the model disciple to start with. His love relationship developed through forgiveness and rebuke from Jesus. And if you back away from Jesus' rebukes, you will never develop your love relationship with him. because his love is a tough love, and he only ever points things out not to humiliate us but to draw us back to himself. So we repent and we begin again. And John had to do that a few times. John, maybe the seating plan with him next to Jesus had gone to his head a bit one day, and he came with his brother and said, there's something we would like you to do, and this is what it is. Let one of us sit at your right hand and the other at your left in your glory. And Jesus said, you don't know what you're asking. Can you drink the cup I drink or be baptized with the baptism I'm baptized with? And they said, we can. Young, foolish boys. And Jesus said to them, you will drink the cup I drink. But to sit at my right hand or left hand is not for me to grant. And of course, John went on to drink the cup of suffering and the cup of loneliness. And when he writes the revelation, and he writes about Jesus, Jesus is the Lamb on the throne, and John's not in the slightest bit interested anymore on sitting on the throne next to him. It's all gone. Jesus has burnt self away out of John, and all he's seeing now is Jesus, the Lamb on the throne. And there was a moment when John displayed great pride and prejudice, actually. The disciples were returning from up north to Jerusalem for the Passover, and they went into a nearby village, and it was a Samaritan village. But the people didn't welcome them. So when the disciples, James and John, saw this, they said, Lord, do you want us to call down fire from heaven and destroy them? And Jesus turned and he rebuked them. And later he actually sent him to Samaria, which was a wonderful thing, and he gave him a new name, Boanerges, son of thunder. This is John, the disciple whom Jesus loved. So John at one point wanted what wasn't his to have, a seat next to Jesus. He didn't want people to have what was their right to have, the good news about Jesus. And when they were in the Garden of Gethsemane, he went and slept with everybody else when Jesus needed a friend with him. But through Jesus's death and resurrection, John stays closer and closer, and he begins to drink the cup that he so confidently said he could before. Verse 9, he is your companion in the suffering and kingdom and patient endurance that are ours in Jesus. You see, when Paul says, I want to know Christ and the power of his resurrection, it doesn't stop there. It says, and the fellowship of his suffering. And if we're going to get drawn into a love relationship with Jesus, we are going to get drawn into the fellowship of his suffering. On Patmos, John is drinking the cup of sorrow and isolation and rejection and persecution and misunderstanding and abandonment and forsakenness at the mercy of cruel people. He's no longer sitting at the table with the 12 disciples close to Jesus, but he's still leaning into Jesus. And he kept leaning into Jesus. When Jesus was put on trial, he was there. John, Simon Peter, was following Jesus, and so was another disciple, and it was John. He stuck by him. He stuck by him at the cross. He was the only disciple left at the end. Everybody else had gone, and John's standing there. And John knew the love of Jesus. When Jesus got Peter aside and he asked him three times, Peter, do you love me? Do you love me? Do you love me? Do you know what he was asking him? Do you know that I love you? We love because he first loved us. If I can say I love you, Jesus, I can only say that because I've allowed him to love me. And Peter is with Jesus in a place of shame. He's disappointed with himself. He's betrayed him. And Jesus is saying, it's okay. If you continue to let me love you, you will love me back. And together we will go and love the world. Do you love me is not a rebuke. It's saying, do you know that I love you and you will receive my love? And then you know you are beloved. It's the love of Jesus that transforms people. The love of Jesus. We can only know the love of Jesus because we have the life of Jesus. But if you just have the life of Jesus and you don't have the love of Jesus, then you are living a very impoverished discipleship. You won't love back unless you allow yourself to be loved. John's journey was to know Christ and the power of his resurrection and the fellowship of his suffering, which took him deeper and deeper into the love of Jesus. Many of us, when we enter into suffering, we don't enter into fellowship, we walk away. We say, I'm done, I gave my life to you, and look what you did to me. We're over. And that's the very moment, that's your Patmos, when he comes in the clouds, and he says, it's just you and me. Let me love you. And then you can be free to love me back. I don't know about your Patmos. I don't know about your prison and the island you're on. But I do know when you get to Patmos, you have a choice to make. You can be on the island, miserable, self-pitying, saying, go away, I'm done. I don't want anything from anybody. Or you can be broken on the island and say, we're finally just me and God. I'm on the island, but I'm in the spirit. Look, Jesus says, look, and I'll show you a whole other world coming in the clouds. 42 times in Revelation, he says to John, I saw. 19 times he says, look. I don't know what God wants you to see on this journey. I don't know when he's told you to look beyond what you've been presented with, temples and ruins and goddesses, and whether you're actually starting to see behind these things, what he wants you to see from your prison. Two men looked through prison bars. One saw mud, the other saw stars. And it's our choice. And if you've only seen mud so far, literally buildings, my prayer is that you will begin to see stars. Let's pray together. Lord Jesus, thank you that you know each person here by name. We are fearfully and wonderfully made. And the whole of life is simply about being drawn back into the heart of your Father. About allowing you to bring your life, to bring life to us. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you for your patience. Thank you that when we reach the uttermost, you love us to the uttermost, and you are there. In Jesus' name, amen.
You are watching a special edition of Living Truth, recorded on location in Greece and Turkey. Our Living Truth group enjoyed traveling and worshiping together, and meditating on God's Word as a community, or in quiet reflection.
I was inspired to come here on this journey because I was on the previous trip, which is in Israel in 2013. My wife and I, we both enjoy going to places we've never been to before, and just this leaping into the unknown was kind of fun for us and something we look forward to. It was way beyond expectation. The ruins in Ephesus were absolutely magnificent. It's very inspiring being here, and it's good to have Charles and Hillary speaking to us and chatting with them and having breakfast with them as well. I think the majority of us are used to traveling to so-called tried and true places, things we're comfortable with. I suspect few people would think of traveling to places like Turkey, but it's such a beautiful country and such amazing scenery and such rich history and architecture, you know, things, you know, beyond my imagination. I would definitely encourage them to come on journey here again. The tour guides are great, and we're all together. The bus captains keep us all together. The tour guides make sure we hear what they say. Transferring on and off the boats, the guides there are very professional. I really recommend this trip. For one thing, the weather was way beyond expectation. We've had sunny days every day. The landscape and the scenery and everything, the history, rich history, and the biblical, tying the biblical references to the physical places, that was an eye-opener for me. With a couple of days of a quiet retreat after a hectic journey, it's extremely good change of pace. If I were to offer one word to describe this journey, fantastic.
Awaken in Israel. Imagine your journey. Immerse your senses. Ignite your faith. Awaken 2016 Israel is a once-in-a-lifetime exploration of origin and destiny. From November 17th to the 27th, 2016, Join Charles and Hilary Price and the Living Truth family as we travel to Israel. Immerse your senses. Experience the sights and sounds of the lands of the Bible. During this 10-day adventure, we'll visit Jerusalem, the Sea of Galilee, the Mount of the Beatitudes, the Dead Sea, as well as other amazing destinations. Ignite your faith through worship and the teaching of Charles and Hilary Price and special guests during a 2-day haven of reflection on the shore of the Sea of Galilee. To reserve your spot now, visit awaken2016.com or call 1-877-465-3442. Awaken Israel 2016. It's your time.
During our trip, we enjoyed a rejuvenating respite with Hilary Price.
So Hilary, here we are in this beautiful land, Greece just behind us, the beautiful Aegean Sea, and it's been an amazing journey that we've been able to share with a bunch of beautiful people. Just tell me a little bit about what this has meant for you personally, just being on this journey and seeing these sites and being with the people that we've been able to be with.
Well, it's very interesting to come back here because I was here, it was 40 years since I was here. I came as a student backpacking around Europe, and Greece was one of the places I really wanted to come to. So I spent about a week here. I was 19, so now I'm back. I'm a lot older. I'm a mother and a grandmother now. But Athens is still full of traffic. I think for me, I entered this journey actually long before I got here because I started to look at what I was going to teach when I got here. And that's really been my focus. We joined the journey when it was already underway a little bit. And you know, it's great to invest in folks through the months of study you've done. And then you come here and then you see it in context. So for me, the journey isn't just looking what I'm seeing there, it's looking with the eyes of thinking, okay, this is a picture, this is a revelation that we're actually going to unpack. And they don't know that, the people who are looking at it, and the relevance of what they're seeing, but it's kind of exciting because, you know, it's like they're all gathering pieces of the jigsaw and they get a bit here and a bit here, and then, you know, when you begin to teach, you start to put them together and a much bigger picture emerges. So I'm just all...
Well, and you have the opportunity to anticipate that too, because you know what you're going to be teaching on. And as you're on the Isle of Patmos, and of course today you're speaking about John and that experience, so you're already pre-working that through.
Yeah, very much so.
As you're experiencing that. What was it like knowing that you're going to be teaching that and then being on Patmos? Were you on Patmos before when you were here years ago? Okay, so what was that like? What eyes did you look at Patmos with?
Probably unrealistic romantic eyes when I first came, because I had studied and stepped into it in my imagination, and it was John and Jesus, and now we're on a cruise ship, we're getting a boat, we're getting on a bus, and I was thinking, no, this is now Azorit, and then we're being shown a cave, you know, where John received the revelation, maybe. But I had to kind of look beyond it and say, well, yes, he was in a cave, and you know, this could have been it. But I didn't want all the other stuff. But nobody else was looking through those eyes, because in my mind, I'd pared it down to this lump of rock, this phenomenal encounter, and what that means in our lives. So it was a bit of a struggle, actually, just to not see the other stuff.
Tune out all the noise.
Yeah.
Yeah. Interesting.
Yeah.
So in your study, and I know you spent a lot of time, as you always do, just in preparation and looking at the context and the environments around the message, did you have opportunity or the desire to really dig into the book of Revelation? I mean, you know, the John's experience in the revelation and his solitude. We'll talk about that in a little bit too, as you did in your message. But what's your perspective on the revelation and on the prophetic word in that context, in the picture of what it is? How do you view that?
Well, I looked at that and thought, I think the most helpful thing for people is to actually decode what they've seen rather than decode something that's a mystery to people all over the world, always will be. And say, why was he writing it? And why he was writing it was to the people there, to tell them what was coming. And it wasn't so much about what was coming, it was about the encouragement that it is coming and I'm still in control. So the details might all be really fascinating, but in the end, the message is, you know, I know, and it's my world, and I will wrap it up when I'm ready.
Right.
So I think when you see that he's writing to those churches so that they will be ready and they will know he's still on board and they are still being comforted and he is challenging them, then the other stuff to me, it's all very exciting, but it's not actually the point.
Interesting. I grew up with a grandfather who was just passionate about prophecy and would spend hour after hour just pointing, they're trying to predict dates and times, and I think there's still a lot of people that are fascinated by it. What do you see as the role of prophecy in Scripture, and what does it do for us? And particularly as you've been sharing about Revelation, just put that in context again for us.
Well, prophecy is the whole thing of foretelling or forthtelling, isn't it? And prophecy doesn't make sense until you look backwards and then you see, oh, this led to this, led to this, led to this. So, I mean, one of the obvious examples of that is Jesus Christ himself, in whom, you know, hundreds of prophecies were fulfilled. But when they were given as individual prophecies, nobody was necessarily understanding that this is what it was going to look like. So I think you have to be very careful with prophecy because you're often only getting a bit of it. So in one generation they got one prophecy about Jesus,
right.
Another generation they got another one, and they could have gone completely off at that one and said, oh, well, this is the one, and then the next generation say, no, well, this is the one, so that couldn't have been the one. And actually, in the end, the amazing thing about Jesus is he fulfills them all.
Right.
And they all seem contradictory and impossible, you know, that he would be called a Nazarene and that he would be, you know, born in Bethlehem, out of Bethlehem, I've called myself, etc. So it didn't make sense. It didn't make sense until, bam, it was all in him, and then it made sense.
Yeah, that makes sense.
So, it's not something I've got enough to work out about life now. And I find that people who get into prophecy get into prophecy.
I just wonder if you could just share a little bit from your own heart and your own life about how you hear from Jesus. I mean, you talk about that conversation and hearing from him and relating to him. And, you know, you share a little bit about how he's spoken to you in dreams,
only
a couple of times, right?
Times.
But how do you hear his voice and how does he speak to you?
Yeah. I hear his voice through turning up in the secret place, day after day after day.
What does that mean, turning up in the secret place?
The secret place for me is the whole, you know, come with me to a quiet place and get some rest. And if you look at the life of Jesus, Jesus continually went alone to be with the Father, that beautiful contradiction of energy that happens alone with the Father. So he, you know, had a boat. He got in a boat. He went off in a boat by himself. He got up in the early morning to pray. Went up the mountain. He had this. The secret of Jesus's life, his public life, was his private life. It was his putting his roots into the Father. I only do those things that please the Father. The Father teaches me. I teach you. You know, apart from me, you can do nothing. But apart from God, Jesus could nothing, do nothing. So he lived in that place of complete dependence, which is nurtured in that alone place. So I have a boat. I don't literally have a boat, but I have a chair with a table and my coaster for my cup of tea and my Bible and my notebook and my devotions. And, you know, if I don't, even if I don't want to, or I'm, you know, fighting with something, I turn up. So that's why I say I just keep turning up. And there are days when I open up what I'm reading, and I might be reading a particular devotion, reading through scripture, I have a notebook, I take notes, something just absolutely pops out of the page, and, you know, it's so clear to me, it's God speaking to me. For example, when I was talking before, I talked about how God said to me on a ferry on the way to a Greek island, I'll never leave you, I'll never forsake you. The day I set off on this journey, I opened up my devotion, and what was my verse? I'll never leave you, I'll never forsake
wow.
you. And God does that to me so many times, and it's just this beautiful whisper that says, I'm here, I know your journey, and we're still in this together. And it doesn't happen every day, but it's the whisper of God to me that's the dynamite of God that continually reassures me that he did never leave me and forsake me, that
right.
he is with me. And he knows things about my soul that nobody knows, nobody will ever know, and he speaks them back out of scripture to me and shows me this. I know what's hurting your heart. I know what dungeon you're in, and uses words back to me that I actually have already identified. So, and I say turning up because if you just spent time with God when you felt like it, then you wouldn't have an ongoing relationship.
Right.
as in the marriage, you know, just sure. thought, well, I don't want to see you today.
Yeah.
I mean, we live in the same house, but we won't actually. So it's a discipline that in the end becomes incredibly fruitful, actually. He wakens me morning by morning, like, you know, like one being taught, and he gives me a word that sustains the weary. And I always say, you can only give what you've received. You can only right. teach what you've been taught. I have nothing to give other than what Jesus has personally taught me.
Early Christians were often at risk of personal danger through conflict and persecution. Today, there are still places where to proclaim the Christian faith is considered illegal and can result in imprisonment or even death. This has been the pattern of history. For modern-day Christians who risk their lives spreading the gospel, their journey, like Paul's, is one of suffering and hardship, yet incredible hope. Often, the church grows more rapidly in these countries than in those with less persecution. They are, in many ways, living out the stories they read in the Bible about the early church. It's sobering to think that there may come a time in our own country when we are required to make that same kind of sacrifice. I'm Jared Earhart. Join us next time for more Living Truth.